You talked about cutting the clover. So that's something that Jeremy and I have talked to a couple guys on here. It seems controversial, not as much as the moon, but like, you know, we've had guys ranging from, you got to cut it like every time, whatever, 2-3 times a year to like, not at all. I'm just curious where you stand on that and why.
I think that the not at all opinions have just come about recently with some results of some studies that show the measurable tonnage of the field and the productivity as far as before, during, and after a cut versus a standalone field that's never been cut. You know, it really does make sense when you think about it as far as the newly emerging growth is where the protein is at. And those tender young tops are the most desirable and the highest of protein levels. Although I take a balanced approach to it on my property, if it's tall and full and there's not a lot of weed competition going on. And by the way, I use herbicides on my clover too, but I try to use the mechanical control versus herbicide control as much as I can. But there's no doubt about it. Clipping your clover occasionally in a season where there's a lot of moisture and it's growing well is a wonderful way to combat weed competition. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about it, because clover flushes back out so quickly. Now, within reason, if you turn your back on your farm and come back 2 months later, you're going to have a weed infested field more than likely, because it just does need that. You think about the deer are always working that clover down, and it's allowing those weeds to poke through that into that sunlight. But where I'm very, very skeptical or cautious, I should say, is when it's hot and dry. I never try to mow my clover when it's hot and dry at all.
Sure.
A year like this year we're having here in Indiana, you could mow your clover once a month and be just fine, because 4 to 6 days later, it's back up to 6 to 8 inches tall again.
Right.
Now, having some foresight going into the fall here, just let's say August does turn off dry and we get into September, and I'm battling, do I want to do a setback now or do I leave it go? I'll probably err on the cautious side and let it go, especially if it's turning off drier.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I get what they're saying about removing the expense and the time involved versus the benefit of mowing. Are you gaining anything?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're definitely losing that valuable available tonnage. But I guess it's, again, we're getting back to site-specific, farm-specific. What does your field look like? Does it have a lot of weeds? And is the moisture there will allow you to get away with it without hurting
Is the weeds the primary reason for mowing? Or is it kind of my...
I think it's three spans there. It's mechanical method for controlling those broadleafs, right? You're not going to...
Which works.
And if you mow... Because if you mow your grasses, you still need to spray those out, right? You're not killing them.
But
your
broadleaf, clover. Right.
Yeah. It's then, if you mow... The anti-mowing people are saying, if you mow, you're reducing the biomass of that plot, which you very well could be. But if you are mowing...
Is that the main argument against mowing?
Yes. Okay. If you are mowing, you are creating new shoots, which, to Tom's point, are usually more preferred, higher crude protein.
Well, that was going to be my follow-up question. Have there been any studies to show that, or is it just purely observational?
That's the trade-off, I think, though. Biomass versus new shoots and protein.
Correct. I'd say that's a great way to just do the ultimate, you know, comparison or you know, your choices of options there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, I think if you have broadleafs and annuals in there,
there. It definitely helps with the broadleafs. But there are studies that show that the newer shoots and stuff are 100%. Have higher protein or are more desirable.
But they've been around a long time. You can
really,
and it's real easy to go out. You could do it yourself. You could pull the tops off of several different types of plants and send them off and have them analyze for crude protein levels.
Who was it?
It's not many people think about that, but that's certainly an viable option for you. But heck, since forages have been raised for grazing animals, that's been a common understanding that.
Does Tom know Bronson?
Probably.
That newest growth is going to be the highest level of protein.
Yeah. So we had a podcast not long ago with Bronson Strickland from Mississippi State Deer Lab. And Bronson and I, we've always talked about this because he's looking at it from a biomass standpoint.
Okay.
And he's saying, if you want to have optimal biomass, and keep in mind here, kind of the parallel to it is that yes, if I mow it and new shoots come up, they're higher protein, probably more digestible because they're younger. But there's a level to which a deer can't process that much protein, right? So if it was eating something that's 35% crude protein, it's going to poop out 15+
percent.
So he's
saying that higher protein doesn't necessarily
matter. It just depends on where you're at. Now, again, and this is one of the reasons that we plant a lot of white clover over red clover is because the more stemmy, right, these clovers are, and this is not a scientific word, stemmy, but the harder it is to digest, thus the less protein they're extracting out of it.
Yeah.
Most white clovers are not as
leafy.
They're more leafy based, but as that thing matures, right, it does become tougher in its composition, thus becomes less digestible versus if you mowed and it's very new, you know, young, nutritious, luscious, like that kind of thing. So I think it's fine lines, right? If me personally, I would mow to control broadleafs. And if I get a benefit of cutting some of the clover on that and creating new young shoots, awesome.
Mm-hmm.
But if I don't have to, if I look at a clover plot and it's not overrun by broadleafs, I probably won't cut it.
It almost seems like you need several factors. Like if there aren't 100% broadleaves and they are getting mature, like I don't know if that's enough to cut.
Well, like, and even what Tom's saying, if it's dry and hot, even if there are broadleaves, probably don't cut it.
Right.
Yeah. You're going to put it into an even more stressful situation. And when you guys think about the appearance or the presence of blooms and blossoms is an indicator that that clover is ending, it's getting near the end of its growing cycle and it's about to put on its flowering so it can put on seeds.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an indicator. It always has been for me is that you see a field full of blooms. And the good times when you can mow, if your field's full of blossoms, it's about done. And therefore those tender shoots are starting to harden off and it's ending that cycle. So it's a good time to think about mowing if it's a good season, if you have that weed competition.
Sure.
But to remove it, just to mow it for, especially in white clover, as that's a great point too. And even further dialing it in between white clovers, you have the improved white clovers, which are the combination. It's a hybrid cross between Ladino clover and the Dutch white.
Yep.
You're getting that low lush tendency of a Dutch white, but also the big leaves of the Ladino.
Mm-hmm.
And that stemminess you're talking about is that lignin. That's a non-digestible
starch
that's hard for them to process, but those more soft vegetative masses of the lower lignin plants are obviously in our world, we're not putting that up for hay. So you don't need them to stick together in a bale once it's dried down. We're just really strictly talking about browsing animals here that benefit better from that type of a plant. So if you're dealing with white clovers and you're not battling weeds, let it go. I mean, let it go.
Yeah, no, I think that's a really good point. And it is, it's situational. You know, what's the weather? What's your property look like? Maybe you mow one, maybe you don't mow another. You stagger them out. I think that it ultimately comes down to there's a lot of people that are mowing and doing things in the right strategy. And then the majority of clover guys are mowing because they just like the look of what it looks like after they're done mowing.
They just think they're supposed to.
Yeah, they're just like, man, that looks great. And they have no idea that they could potentially be reducing the biomass and not working as well, or they just mowed a bunch of grass that ultimately is going to probably come back thicker and faster than the clover that they just cut. So there's a lot of things there. And I get it. People are absolutely afraid of using herbicides on their food plots. They don't like to. They'd rather mow than use herbicides. And I get that. And I do too, to a point. But you have to understand what you're dealing with in that plot and then what's the final benefit. I mean, there's a reason you should be able to get 4, 5, 6 years out of a great perennial white clover plot is because you maintain it and manage it correctly. Take me.